Hi, I'm Max.
And I'm Skylar.
During quarantine, we decided to start watching Bob's Burgers to see what it was all about.
It didn't take long for us to become completely obsessed with the show.
But one of the things we love the most are the brilliant end credit sequences.
Which is why we created this podcast.
Each week, we're going episode by episode to talk about the elaborate end credits.
We're excited to have you join us on the very first credit score spinoff, Bob's Credits.
We'll make sure the Bob's Burgers end credits get the credit they're due.
Chippy and Chippy and Chip-Chip-a-roo. Why are you looking at me like that?
What is that? Because I like know it but don't know it.
Chippy and Chippy and Chip-Chip-a-roo.
Wait, I got it. Girls being girls. Right. Group.
Yeah, from this episode.
Ah, this is such a good episode.
It is a good episode. Hello.
Hi.
We are here to do a podcast about Bob's Burgers.
I'm really excited about this one.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I am too. This is a great episode.
Great credits.
Great credits. Great music. That Chip-Chip-a-Roo intro will make sense.
Great Gene moments.
Biscuit, make yourself at home. We've got an episode to talk about here. There you go. Biscuit is burrowing into...
my side.
Your side.
Come here, honey bee.
Bisque bee and bisque bee and bisque bee and bisque. Okay, Biscuit. Should we get into Bob pun or Max pun and then get into the episode?
Yeah, okay. Please.
Your first pun is the Spice is Right burger.
Wait, you should have done this for game show day.
I should have.
Yeah.
For last week's episode?
Yeah.
Too many game shows.
Max.
Yes. Your next pun is Beats of the Southern Wild burger.
Max.
Bob.
Oh, is that a recent one?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
That movie's years old now.
Oh.
Yes, I'm going to sing this one. Sitting on the dock of the bay, leaf burger.
Bob.
Max.
Okay, that is... so good.
Thank you. You can use that one, Bob's Burgers Riders. I know you're listening. We see you.
Permission granted.
And your final pun is Barley Davidson Burger. Comes on a barley roll.
Bob?
Yeah.
I cannot see you being like, oh, you know what I'd like? A barley roll.
That's what gave it away. I shouldn't have put that part.
Yeah.
Because I don't even know what a barley roll is.
Yeah.
That's it. Good job.
Did I? I don't even know.
I don't even know either. I never keep track. Are we ready to get in this episode?
I'm so excited.
I'm beyond ready. Can we have the title and synopsis?
You're beyond ready.
I'm
Whoa.
Beyond ready. Can we have the title and synopsis for season 3, episode 18, please, Skylar?
The title is The Kids Run the Restaurant.
I wonder what's going to happen.
When Bob slices his finger crotch open, Linda leaves Tina in charge of Jean and Louise while she closes the restaurant and takes Bob to the hospital. Tina attempts to be the cool babysitter, but it's not working. Louise wants to make some cold, hard cash, so she convinces her siblings to open the restaurant. It does not go well, so Louise, the cunning businesswoman she is, shifts directions. She opens the meat grinder, an underground gambling ring in the basement. Gene's in charge of the entertainment, which is great because he's been putting together a girl group called the Cutie Patooties. Naturally, this plan cascades into chaos when Mr. Fish Odor's rock, paper, scissors winning streak puts the kids in major debt.
This episode came out on April 21st, 2013. It was written by Stephen Davis and Kelvin Yu and directed by Boobon Lim and Kyung-Ki Lim.
This is a great episode. There's so many things just from my description that I want to comment on. The Cutie Patooties, you know, Louise acting like kind of like a...
The Cutie Patooties are something that it's like the first time you watch Bob's Burgers through that stays with you.
Yeah.
Like Jean started this girl group. It's such like a... It's the runner, obviously, of the show.
Yeah.
Like there's the... kids running the restaurant. There's Bob and his finger.
And his blood aversion.
And then there's like Gene putting this girl group together. And it's just so funny.
So what I find so particularly funny is that he didn't put this girl group together for this business venture. He was like, no, I've been working on this, last week at school. I think it's so funny.
It's so good. And I think I want to just play the clip right when they perform Girls Being Girls, because just gotta love Girls Being Girls so much.
Let's do it.
All right, patooties, get your cutie faces on. Misty, you're singing lead, and it's time for this star to shine, just like we rehearsed.
We didn't rehearse.
Oh my God, we didn't rehearse. All right, even better. It'll be fresher. Go out there. Go, 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 go.
What do I do?
Girls being girls, being girls, being girls, girl, grow.
Girls being girls, being girls,
being girls. No. I whisper, you don't whisper. You sing it.
Girls being girls, being girls, being girls.
Come back, come back, come back. Not your night, not your night.
Girl, grow.
We're gonna take a quick fiver, technical difficulties. In the meantime, Sammy Hagar, everybody.
First of all, Gene's outfit, the minute,
yes.
Like, with the collar and the gold chains with
the
his chest exposed.
Chains.
Yeah.
This sleazy, like, what, 80s agent, kind of?
Maybe even earlier, like Motown.
Yeah.
Yeah, guy behind a girl group.
And then he has, like, a tiny dash of stage mom, too. Like, the fact he does this fabulous choreography that he has clearly created himself in the wings, which I love. It's so good. And
yeah.
Then I feel like this just needs to be, this whole podcast will just be an episode appreciation podcast. But Louise being the ringleader of this is fantastic. But then Tina having to be, like, the waitress, like.
Yeah.
How would you describe Tina in this episode?
She's like she's like the host, kind of. Like she's got to be like the schmoozer.
A little flirting.
Yeah. But she's so monotone all the time. It's great.
I think she should like flirt a little.
Yeah.
She's so good. Not to take away from Gene, because he's phenomenal.
Everyone is great in this episode. And the Bob storyline is great, too, where they go and they have this very young doctor. who's
Linda
putting,
says the funniest thing. He's like, I want to breastfeed your face.
he's doing stitches for the first time on Bob and ends up putting Bob in like a whole cast pretty much for his fingers.
I hope Bob being scared of blood comes back in the series, because it's really funny. I actually have like a little bit of like fun facts about kind of the finger crotch situation.
Oh,
should we just like
I
go
love
there?
Finger crotch fun facts. That should be a segment
on
the show.
Don't Google finger crotch.
Oh.
I had to Google it a lot this week.
Did you put on safe search?
I did not.
You should have.
I did not have the foresight. Okay. So, according to the Bob's fan wiki page, the finger crotch, which is what the young doctor refers to as the skin in between your fingers, which is where Bob cut himself. So, the wiki page says that is a reference to Buffy the Vampire Slayer, an episode called Chosen, in which Buffy defeats the evil Caleb by cutting him in half from the crotch up with a scythe.
Okay.
That's what I said, right?
Sometimes some of this information is like, what?
Okay, so I'm like, they must be right. Okay, that's such a specific detail. So I went back through the whole script to look at every time they mentioned finger crotch, and I cannot make the connection. So, but I'm not a Buffy fan. I think I would be, because I'm a fan of Buffy fans. Like, anyone who's a hardcore Buffy fan has great taste in TV. That's a side tangent. But so I'm wondering if maybe you have to watch the episode to get the finger crotch reference, and maybe like you have to be a Buffy buff.
I still don't see the connection.
I don't see it either, because it's a crotch. It's
yeah,
not a
but
finger.
Then you could connect any like crotch reference to
I don't
finger
know
crotch.
But this is the exciting news that I want to tell you.
Okay.
So while I'm down this like finger crotch Buffy,
what a dark place you were in, and I was around. What was this? Is this?
You're
is,
probably just shoving your phone in my face, saying, "Is this funny,
Skylar?" Did you like meditate after when you were done? It sounds.
No, this is so interesting. Just hold tight. So I'm sleuthing the web, and I find an episode of Buffy called Double Meat Palace.
Okay.
Okay. The episode, Buffy works at a hamburger place, and the employees mysteriously go missing.
They're being used in the burgers.
They are being used in the burgers, which, if you remember the pilot episode, not the pilot episode of Bob's, but the Bob's Burger pitch was that this was a family who owned a cannibal burger joint.
Yeah.
So do you think Lauren Bouchard is like a huge Buffy fan?
Could be. I still don't understand the crotch reference to Buffy, but...
Did I just like waste 10 minutes of your life, or do you find this interesting?
I find it interesting. I think it's interesting that was on a fan site. I have a fun fact regarding that storyline. I don't know if you have it.
Oh, tell me.
So do you know who does the voice of... It's his doctor in this is Dr. Eigerman. Is
okay, the name of the doctor. I don't
know. The young, like, child doctor. Do you know who does the voice of Dr. Eigerman?
Mm-mm.
Johnny Pemberton, who we love from Superstore. He's Bo on Superstore.
Stop.
Listeners, if you don't watch Superstore, that's fine. But Bo is a recurring character on the show. And Johnny Pemberton as Bo is so funny. If you just, like, Google on YouTube, Bo Superstore, like, best moments or something. Yeah. You're just like... He's so funny, but he's the voice of this young doctor.
Whoa.
Yeah.
You just blew my mind. That's exciting.
It's very exciting, especially if you watch Superstore, because Bo is one of the best things about that show.
Oh, I hope he gets more work on this show.
I hope so, too. I'd love to see him doing more voices on here. Do you have any other fun facts for us?
I actually don't have any more fun facts other than Gene has a line, and he says, "There's Arbor Day? Who needs that?" And this episode actually aired the Sunday before Arbor Day in 2013. So that's kind of fun.
Is that a tree day?
I think so.
Okay. Who does need that?
I feel you, Gene.
Yeah.
Well, we do need more trees. So I do have just a little thing. So many of their classmates get to be in this episode, which is so fantastic. Zeke is amazing.
He's the bouncer.
He's the bouncer, of course. But here's the thing. There's no Jocelyn.
No Tammy in this episode either. Tammy's not invited.
Yeah. Don't you think she would have been fabulous?
We've said this before, yes. But Jocelyn is going to come later. Like, she's going to start being a regular in the kids group later. She was kind of like, even though she was in like the first season, I think it was kind of a late find that she was this great, funny character with these hilarious zingers that would come in.
She would have been a good cutie patootie, too.
It's true. She'd be great. Speaking of the cutie patooties, real quick, one of them, Dottie Minerva, who he calls Dottie Minerva, is voiced by Wendy Molyneux. One of the Molyneux sister writing team we love.
And what's Lizzie is her
Lizzie's
sister's name.
Lizzie,
I wonder why she doesn't voice any of the characters.
Yeah.
We were just listening to a podcast with them on, and I think she would be great for one of the high schoolers.
Yeah, but it sounded like Wendy was more like improv the improv worlds before Lizzie came in and started writing with her.
So maybe she was
more performer as well as a writer. I don't know.
Exactly. Definitely.
Hey, Wendy and Lizzie, if you want to come on here and chat with us, we'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
If we're getting any facts about you wrong and you want to set the record straight, stop writing Deadpool 3. That's not important. Come talk to us. That's what matters.
We're just like Wendy and Lizzie fangirls. So
totally. We're fangirls being girls. Fangirl group. Okay.
Okay.
We would be good in this group because we're so unrehearsed.
I do know Gene's choreography by heart, so.
Should we get into these end credits? Let's go to the last few moments of the episode.
I honestly could watch this episode again, like, right now.
It's so good. Okay, so the last few moments is Bob has now, in order to beat Mr. Fishoder, he had to break his stitches to do scissors against Mr. Fishoder, because Mr. Fishoder did not think Bob was going to go scissors because of his finger crotch situation.
Ugh.
And blood shoots out everywhere, and Bob faints again.
Uh-huh.
Pass out if we're not in trouble.
You're not in trouble.
Yay.
All right, kids, help me get him in the car. We're going back to the hospital.
Yay.
Hit it. Oh, he's dead.
Okay, so Tina's excited about going to the hospital, and immediately cuts to... We hear this music, and it cuts to what, Skylar? What do we see on the screen here?
We see Linda in color on a kind of rinky-dink stage, like with wooden floors and a curtain that's all black and white. And we have this kind of pink spotlight on her. Once again, she is holding her hands kind of like a seal.
Yeah. We said like she likes to hold her hands with like her fingers dipped below the wrists. That's how she walks kind of. And that's how she dances.
Yeah. And we hear this music, this dun, 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 dun.
Yeah. And she says, hit it. Oh, you did.
Because the music had been playing already.
Let's see what Linda's going to get into here.
When Bob sees blood and screams and passes out, then Mr. Fish checks in and cashes out. What more do you want when kids run the restaurant?
We heard her kind of recapping this episode.
Yes. Fun fact.
Yeah.
Do you automatically know what this composition is parroting? Are we going to do this parroting thing again?
Parodying. We did this before.
Right? No.
Okay, ask me again.
Do you know what the song is parodying?
It sounds familiar. It's like a famous show tune, right?
Yes.
I can't think of it off the top of my head, but...
It's Cole Porter's Anything Goes, which I didn't necessarily get right off the bat, but then I went and listened to the chorus of that song, and it's really close. Do you want to listen to it?
To Little Anything Goes?
Yeah.
Is Anything Goes from a Broadway show? Is the show Anything Goes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good offers to who once knew better words, now only used for letter words, writing prose. Anything goes.
Just like that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Do you hear it now?
I totally hear it. Should we go back to the beginning of the...
Yeah, why not? It's so good.
Also, singing?
I do need to say that when the kids are trying to run the restaurant, their first take, a sailor comes in to buy some food and to scare her off.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. They try to sell her chicken.
And kale.
Yeah.
Tina's doing something with kale.
Hit it!
Oh, it sounds just like it.
When Bob sees blood and screams and passes out, then Mr. Fish checks in and cashes out. What more do you want when kids run the restaurant?
So she's dancing all around in front of this curtain.
The choreography is so good. My favorite move is when she goes, Bob passes out. She, dramatically puts her arm over her head.
Yeah. And then as this music kind of picks up and she says the kids run the restaurant, the curtains open. We see a sign on the top that says the meat grinder.
Yep.
And
sparkly flash. It almost looks like Vegas.
Yeah. It's like
classic Vegas.
Exactly. And we have the backup dancing sailors come in, four of them.
Yeah. Kind of look
two
like
from each side.
Doing tap dancey moves.
Hey, sailor. Oh, nice pants. Marshmallow played a game of Surgery Sam, and all this cause Bob cut his hand. What more do you want when kids run the restaurant?
They're doing the fan pinwheel arms, the sailors in the background.
Yeah, and then they eventually lift her up on their shoulders. I like the little mumble at the end.
Can I hear it?
Yeah.
What more do you want when kids run the restaurant?
Na-na-na-na-na-na. I like the Marshmallow shout out too.
Yes.
Because Marshmallow does come to the casino.
Great entrance.
Yeah, those are the end credits to the kids run the restaurant.
I love them. Do you want to, I know we could hear them pretty well, but do you want to read us the lyrics?
Yeah. So she says, when Bob sees blood and screams and passes out, then Mr. Fish checks in and cashes out. What more do you want when the kids run the restaurant? Then she says, hey, sailor. Oh, nice pants. When they're bending over.
I couldn't tell if she said pants or cans.
Pants. Cans would be funny. And then the second verse is, Marshmallow played a game of Surgery Sam. I like singing it. Marshmallow played a game of Surgery Sam, and all this because Bob cut his hand. What more do you want when kids run the restaurant?
It is so good.
It's a fantastic song. They're fantastic end credits. Highlights, slow lights.
But here's the thing. Normally when we have a fantastic song, the song's in the episode. This was created specifically for the credits. And that just...
Which I think...
brings my appreciation up so high.
Yeah, and I think we're going to start to see a lot more of that as they move forward. They really start to put more... They create... Yeah, it's more... I say that I love the kitchen thing and they just do little bits, but they really do see these end credit sequences as a part of the episode and put a lot of work into them.
I just love them so much. But you have a whole thing about it being out of the kitchen. How do you feel about this?
I don't need it to be in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. I really don't. I like when it's in the kitchen. I like when there's little subtle things, but when it goes above and beyond outside of the kitchen, mm-hmm. I love it.
But also this episode is like in the basement and the stage feels like it's in the basement. So it kind of does feel like a continuation of the episode too.
And it's just, this is a song Linda would write.
I loved the choreography. You should, this is one where it would be so boring for us to just explain the choreography to you, but go and just look at what it would take. You would have to choreograph this before you could draw this.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing? Like, do they have a choreographer?
I'm sure they do. They probably like just have to say, like, they have to see how things are posed and stuff. So they have to, before they draw it.
I mean, honestly, you could hire me for that.
You want to be the Linda dancer?
I want to be the credits choreographer.
Okay. Well, yeah. Skylar's officially putting her in her bid to be the credits choreographer for Bob's Burgers. Please.
Yes, please.
Yeah. We'll ask them all on those sisters when they're
podcasting with us.
Yeah. They could put you in Deadpool 3 too. You want to be a CGI creature of some sort?
Ooh, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
I'd be like a little mini Creakin.
A dancing Creakin.
Oh my gosh. I love it. This should be our next animated film. Like, our next.
Our next. We have so many.
The success over here is...
We're so tired of competing with Pixar.
That's why you didn't see our first two films.
Right. Are we ready to score?
Yeah. I'm a little nervous, though.
Okay. We score on a scale of 1 to 10 H's at the end of Tina's Do you want to go first or do you want me to go first?
Whichever.
I'll go first.
Okay.
I am going to give them these end credits 10 H's.
Me too. Okay. I was so nervous.
It's just fantastic. Like, Linda, this is the peak Linda. Linda at her best.
We also didn't do, I don't know if we did highlights, but that little like murmuring she does is fantastic. Thank you for pointing that out.
You're welcome.
It's like she's forgotten the lyrics or she's just like...
I love the lyrics recapping what happened in just like, it's like three or four lines that recaps the entire episode pretty much, because the rest of the stuff is just like repetitive.
I love it. It's so good.
They're great end credits. I really like them a lot.
It's also fun. Like, I don't know if it's like in Sex and the City, they call it Fleet Week. So I don't know if it's Fleet Week.
With all the sailors in there in town.
But they planted the sailors in the episode.
Yeah.
Maybe just for these end credits. It's possible. I don't know. It's so good.
And also sailors are like, that was always a big thing in older musicals for some reason, right? Yes. Like dancing
South
sailors.
Pacific.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. What's the Gene Kelly, Frank Sinatra, Anchors Away? They were sailors in that.
I mean, you gotta love a sailor.
I guess so.
Okay. I did have a thought.
Okay.
And I hate hypothesizing because we just gave these tens. Do you kind of want to hear the full lyrics to Girls Being Girls?
I gave this a 10, but that's my, if I had one kind of like disappointing thing, is that I would love to see the Cutie Patooties performing in these credits. Whether it's like the bad version or they've like rehearsed or there's like a
full, or it's just Gene,
a full version.
Or maybe Gene lures Louise and Tina in to be his background dancers.
Or it would be funny if it was just Gene doing it at end, like he did in the...
I want to see his lyrics. He wrote Electric Love. Mm-hmm. Think what he could do with Girls Being Girls.
Yeah. I would watch a whole Cutie Patooties episode.
I just remember that they're making a Bob's Burger movie.
Yeah. It was supposed to come out last year. So it's supposed to come out this year. And now that
I hope the Gene world's has kind of a musical storyline in that.
I think there's going to be lots of music in that, in a movie.
Yeah.
For Bob's Burgers.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's it. Thank you everyone for listening. Please follow us on social media. We're Bob's Credits all across the board. Always posting good stuff on there. Support us on Patreon, patreon.com/Bob's Credits. And leave us a review if you would be so kind.
Yes, please.
A good review. Or you don't even have to write anything. Just click 5 stars on your Apple Podcasts if you listen to us there.
Yes, please.
It's very simple. Anything else, Skylar, before we go get some lunch because we're starving?
I don't know. I'm just thinking, you know, you maybe like stay saucy.
Okay, was that like your 1920s like casino?
I just loved how Gene like really channeled a different era.
He always does.
Yeah, so I wanted to do the same. I feel embarrassed by the way you reacted to it, though.
Don't be embarrassed. It was I embarrassed myself at the beginning of every single one of our episodes. We'll see you guys next week.